I even looked away. So this is, I looked at your calendar, this is actually the sixth straight Sunday that I've written a sermon, and I have to tell you that kind of, as that, when that happens, the last couple get a little bit loose, and so this is a little bit loose, and it's a little bit fun this morning, and I wanted to let you in on a little sermon writing secret, which is often when I write a sermon, there's often a song that gets kind of stuck in my head while I'm singing it, and sometimes often the lyrics don't make it into the service, but this morning I thought that since I've been kind of singing this in my head as I was writing it, that I might as well get it stuck in all of your heads too. So I'm going to ask, who knows the song Big Yellow Taxi by Joni Mitchell? And when I say the words to it, you'll know the words. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone, right? They pave paradise, put up a parking lot. Now who knows it? And so what I thought we'd all get it stuck in our heads, and so I invited Eric to be bold enough to sing it out loud, and I invite the rest of us to after he sings it, we're all gonna give it a shot, okay? So just those lines of the chorus.
Don't it always seem to go, but you don't know what you got till it's gone. Pay paradise, put up a parking lot.
All right, now I want you to try it all together, all right?
Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what it's got to fix from? It ain't paradise, put up a parking lot.
Ba-ba-ba-ba. All right, good, very good. Thanks, Eric, being brave enough to do that. If you're like me, there are stories that you may have heard about years and years ago that kind of live in your subconscious, that kind of haunt you, that stories that you remember vividly in some outsized way that exceeds their actual significance in human history. There's stories, maybe you read them in a newspaper or you hear them on the radio and you find yourself years later kind of thinking over them and puzzling about them. And I don't know if you do that, I do that. And so this morning what I'd like to do is I want to begin by telling two of those stories. Both the stories are probably about a decade old, and I've probably forgotten a lot of the details. And they're stories that I find myself just thinking about. They're both true stories, though I remember, they happened so long ago that I've probably remembered them inexactly. The first story that I want to share takes place in rural Tennessee. It happens in a rural community. I invite you to imagine this. A rural community, a community outside of any city limits, so kind of out in the county. A community with no municipal services to speak of. We can picture that, right? However, the residents there have the option of paying an annual fee to be included in the response radius for the nearest city's fire department. People living in the rural county could pay an annual fee that would go to all the costs of maintaining a fire department, and the fire department would then come put out the fire if you had one. And if you chose not to pay this fee, you had the right not to pay it. There was no fine or anything like that. The fire department just wouldn't come out if you had a fire on your property. The policy was actually known as no pay, no spray. And this story happened years and years ago that I find myself thinking about involves one Gene Kranick, whose house caught fire, and when he called 911, was told that he had not paid the annual $75 fee and was not therefore eligible to receive the services of the fire department. The fire department did send a truck out, because it turns out that Kranick's neighbor had paid the fee. So the firefighters literally came with a truck and stood there, prepared in case the fire jumped to his neighbor's property. Gene Kranick and his family lost everything. And the article that I read went on to ask Gene Kranick and the fire chief, respectively, for their comments. Kranick said he knew. He knew he hadn't paid the annual fee, that he said he had either forgotten or that he just hadn't gotten around to it. But that he hoped when he called that the firefighters might have mercy on him, and that he felt he paid too high a price for forgetting to pay the $75 fee. The fire chief, when asked, offered a different explanation. He said his fire department, this is what he said, his fire department was barely getting by, that they were seemingly having to make cuts all the time, that his firefighters were overworked and depended on these annual fees to keep things running. He raised the point that if people thought they only had to pay for the fire department when they needed it, there would be no way to keep a fire department around for when people actually did need it. Don't it always seem to go? You don't know what you've got till it's gone. So this story happened years ago, and I'm kind of haunted by it. I find myself wondering, what became of Gene Kranick and his family? I wonder what became of that fire chief. And this was a very small town. I went online in the small town of South Fulton, Tennessee. I went online, and it's a town of about 2,500 people. And I think in a town that size, in a town that small, surely people know each other, right? That surely Gene and the fire chief must run into each other at the store, or you kind of know where each other are, or at least they must have some mutual acquaintances. And I find myself wanting to know what happened next. But as much as I'm curious about life in South Fulton, Tennessee, I also think of this story and become curious about my own heart. I think about this story and I wonder about my reaction to it. Sometimes I put myself in the place of the fire chief and ask myself, what do I do when I get that call? Or I put myself in the place of the firefighter who gets dispatched. And wonder what I do. And most of the time, you're going to be happy to know, most of the time, I picture myself as this agent of grace and mercy and forgiveness. This believer in abundance who would, send out the trucks anyways and spray the fire anyways. This force that says, well, I will save you this time. Go forth and sin no more. Next time, you better remember. But sometimes, if I'm being honest with you, I'm being honest with myself, sometimes I'm not like that at all. Sometimes I'm that stressed out, burnt out fire chief, trying to just make two and two make five. Sometimes I get a little judgmental and I just want to rail at what I perceive as selfish and entitled behavior. I want to say, it's your fault. You chose that. You chose to live in a place where you don't pay taxes for city services, but you expect to be served when you experience the need. I'm just being honest with you that most of the time I'm the other. But there's times when I get in a mood and I'm that one. There's a second story that haunts me too. It's even of less historical significance than the first one. It's a story that that happened in the town where I used to live. Every day on my commute to and from the church I served, I used to pass by this modest stone church in a residential neighborhood. Nothing really special or outstanding about it. But I just drove by it twice a day. It was a Disciples of Christ Church, I think, though it may have been some part of some other mainline denomination. So one day, as I was reading the local section of the local newspaper, I read an article about how this church had decided to close and would be having its final service at the end of the month. The article mentioned how the church had been around for 60 years, but membership had been dwindling over many years and was now down to about a dozen members. Over a period of years, the congregation had spent through all their savings, forced to lay off staff, gone to having a part-time minister, then gone to having no minister at all. There was nothing spicy about this story. There had been no scandal. There'd been no schism, no conflict, no drama. It's just that this small neighborhood church had dwindled down to a dozen members and then died of natural causes. And that itself would have been unremarkable. I wouldn't have remembered that story. But that's not the story that I think about. You see, the story I think about was published a few weeks later under the headline, "Local Church Holds Final Service." It went on to describe how a standing room crowd had shown up to attend the final service there. People packed in to worship one last time. And the article, as I remember it, included these quotes from people who came to that service. One person said, "Oh, I'm so sad. The church is closing. It's where I got married and where I was hoping my son would get married. But I've not been there since I got married 35 years ago." And another person who lived in the community came to the final service and said, "Oh, I'm so surprised to hear that it's closing. I just sort of assumed it would be there forever." And there were several more quotes in this vein. "Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone?" And this article haunts me. For a long time, I would think about the people who showed up for that final service and kind of what was going through their mind that led them to attend. They were all kind of there to grieve the loss of something they never really recognized was there, or maybe they were grieving the loss of something they never had. And then as I pondered the story, I think about those dozen or so remaining members, and I wonder what could possibly be their reaction to having a packed house at the last service in a church that hadn't had a packed house in a decade. Did it make them, if you were one of those dozen final members, would it make you feel good to know that the church's closing was being acknowledged? Would it make you kind of reconsider your decision to close? I wonder if an 11th hour resurrection is possible here. Would it make you resentful? Where were all these people, their presence and their support during all of our years of toiling in the vineyard? So those were the two stories that I thought about this week as I thought about my topic for this morning, which is about institutions and organizations in our society in this moment in time. What a boring topic. But both of these stories are about, to some extent, our relationships with the institutions among us and how those relationships can change over time, can get out of whack. I don't need to tell you that it's a very tough time these days for many of our civil institutions and civic organizations. There's a lot of our institutions that find themselves under attack these days by malevolent forces aimed at destruction. One thinks of the attacks against the community organizing group ACORN, the unrelenting attacks against Planned Parenthood, or locally, here in Chapel Hill, we know the attacks against the Center for Civil Rights at UNC. It's a tough time for so many institutions and agencies and organizations that a lot of them feel threatened. Public education, environmental agencies, scientific and cultural institutions, unions. We could make a long list together, couldn't we? "Don't it always seem to go, but you don't know what you've got till it's gone." And in some ways, this is new, but in some ways it's nothing new, but it's the continuation of a pattern that we've seen elsewhere in our society for decades. Way back in the year 2000, Harvard sociologist Robert Putnam published a groundbreaking book called Bowling Alone, subtitled The Collapse and Revival of American Community. The book's title comes from sociological data about the decline of participation in bowling leagues. It used to be that people who bowled would join a league with others and kind of join a bowling community, and now they are much more likely. Bowling leagues are kind of fading, and people are much more likely to bowl alone. And the book kind of used that example as its touchstone and showed kind of a declining participation in many clubs and leagues and organizations, and that this was a widespread phenomenon, and not only was it widespread, but it was having a deleterious effect on our lives and our functioning within civic society. That with those, what happens is there's a decline in social capital, is the term that Robert Putnam used. Have I made anyone depressed yet this morning? And then there's the institution of the church, the institution of organized religion. And I think back that I've been told by people since before I even entered divinity school that religion in America was on the wane, that the church was going to go the way of the dodo, and that American religious institutions were on decline, and that I should, you know, if you were smart young man, you put your you know, energy somewhere more fruitful, like Twitter. And I have to tell you, it's let you in a little bit on kind of what I think every week. I'm usually the first one to show up at church on Sunday morning. Bianca was the second one to show up this morning, and there I was. I'm usually the first one to show up. And when nobody else has arrived yet, and I wonder to myself, I wonder as I kind of go about the empty church in the morning, I wonder if nobody's going to show up for service this morning. Maybe this will be the week that organized religion dies. and then the religious education volunteers arrive and set up, and the musicians arrive and begin practicing. That Glenn arrives and begins warming up the community singers. And the flowers appear, and the greeters show up, and the children arrive running, and the congregation arrives, and they continue to fill in during the early parts of the service. I look down at my hymnal during the opening hymn, and then I look up, and there's more people than there were when I looked down. And the visitors introduce themselves, and we welcome the new members, and coffee is full of handshakes and hugs, and a cacophony of voices fill the room, and the annual pledge drive comes around, and everything gets funded. And the programs and the staff and the building all happen. And I leave every single Sunday, I leave church saying, church is alive and thriving. What a good morning. This church is alive and thriving. In many ways, the point that I'm making this morning is really very, very simple. It's something any of us know because it just makes sense. It's not a point that's philosophically or theologically complex. And so if you came this morning thinking that you're going to have your thinking cap, have to put that on and really process some 50-cent words, you don't get that this morning. It's a simple point I'm making, which is that we shouldn't take our institutions for granted, that there's no rule that says they'll always be there, and that it's kind of our responsibility to support and protect and defend and help to build up those institutions that matter. You don't know what you got till it's gone. There's another side to that song, side of the lyrics that Joni Mitchell didn't sing, which is the kind of the counterpoint to you don't know what you got till it's gone. And that's a more positive framing, which is to say, if it didn't exist, we would have to create it. Which rather than takes what is and takes it for granted, takes what is and notices it, and imagines the impoverishment if it wasn't there. When I come to church and I see our Whole Lives program for our children and youth, my daughter is going to be doing the kindergarten hour this year. How did that happen? The kindergarten hour, Whole Lives. When we see that program, you just have to explain, right? If that didn't exist, we would have to create it. Or our campus ministry program. I see the college students come on a Wednesday afternoon, and they gather around, and they have important time together. And I just think, wow, if that wasn't there, we would have to create it. Or a covenant group session that goes really well, or a song by our choir that is so beautiful. You just imagine, If that beauty didn't exist, we would have to create it. And I could go on and on and on. So as you go forth, my message, as you maybe ponder those two stories that have stuck with me, as you go home and wind up singing Joni Mitchell on your car ride home, to notice those things. I think if that wasn't there, we would sure have to build it. Amen. Blessed be. Let's sing one more time this morning. Our closing song is number 128, For All That Is Our Life. 128, one of my favorites, and I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing our closing song this morning.